And a warm welcome to all our listeners this fine morning to Sydney's favorite radio show, Layman Litigators, on Legal 51.3 AM. A big thank you to Annie for submitting today's topic of discussion. Without further ado, let's get discussing. Today we have with us Olivia and Sunny, and the topic of discussion is the following quote. The way to find out whether a witness is lying is to basically confront a witness. Does the witness squirm? Does the witness sweat? Does the witness not have a ready answer? It's that moment that's at the heart of the trial. So, ladies first, what do you think, Olivia?
I think this quote definitely has some merit. Contesting the credibility of a witness by exposing the witness in cross-examination is often key to how a trial progresses. Indeed, compromising the credibility of a key witness proves time and time again to be a vital turning point in a trial. The plethora of provisions in the Uniform Evidence Act concerning credibility, to me, is reflective of how much emphasis is placed on the contesting of a witness's credibility during cross-examination. As an example, I suppose it is only apt to refer to a case we've been following this past week, Regina against George Farrell. As a reminder, this is a case concerning the possession of firearms. I point to the following excerpt.
Could you describe to us what do you see when you enter the property?
There are stairs. When you go upstairs, there is a room on the left-hand side. When I entered the room, there were two bags in the middle of the room.
What were in the bags?
One of them had some guns in it. I didn't see what was in the other bag.
But in your previous statement, you said there was one bag. How come you said there were two bags here?
No, I said there were two bags.
Could you go to page 1980 of the statement? Dated 5th September 2005, you said there was one bag in the room.
There were two bags. I saw them. I know what I saw.
You're lying, aren't you? I suggest to you, sir. You were never there.
No, sir. I am not lying. You are lying.
As you can hear, this was a rather dramatic part of the trial. Here, the defense counsel is challenging a key witness of the Crown. What he did was put to the witness that he was lying.
Just to interject here, sorry, Olivia. For our layman litigators out there, there is a common law rule espoused in Brown and Down where a party intends to lead evidence which will contradict the evidence given by one of their opponent's witnesses or call for an explanation from such a witness. The rule requires that the contradiction be put to the witness in cross-examination.
Yes, that is correct. Thank you, Lewis. The defense counsel did a good job here. He is challenging the witness by referring to a prior inconsistent statement that the witness in question made. Now, in order to do this, that is, to adduce evidence of the prior inconsistent statement, we have somehow got to get past the credibility rule.
The rule under Section 102 prevents credibility evidence from being admitted. Credibility evidence is defined in Section 101A as evidence relevant to the credibility of the witness or person that is relevant only because it affects the assessment of the credibility of the witness or person. It also includes evidence that affects the assessment of the credibility of the witness or person and for some other purpose is not admissible.
Yes. The prior inconsistent statement is relevant to the fact and issue, but it is also relevant to the credibility of the key witness. Since the prior inconsistent statement is technically hearsay, it is inadmissible under the hearsay rule in Section 59. Section 101A deems this prior inconsistent statement as credibility evidence. So ordinarily, the credibility rule would operate to prevent such evidence from being adduced in cross-examination. An exception to that, however, lies in Section 103, where the credibility evidence could be admissible if it could substantially affect the assessment of the credibility of the witness. In Lodi's case, it is explained that for the evidence to have a substantial value, it must have such potential to affect the jury's assessment of the credibility of the witness in respect of the evidence he or she has given that the credibility of the witness cannot be determined adequately without regard to it. It should be noted that although Lodi is decided under the old test of substantial probative value, the very test of substantial effect on assessment of credibility under the new Section 103 is itself imported from Lodi's case. Presumably, the defense counsel was successful in obtaining leave to adduce the evidence of the prior inconsistent statement in cross-examination pursuant to Section 103.
But the witness here denied that he was lying, right?
Yes, which makes things all the more interesting. You see, the defense will undoubtedly want to admit the prior inconsistent statement such that the jury can consider it in their deliberations and come to a conclusion on the credibility of the witness. He cannot keep questioning the witness to try and elicit a different response which could be used as evidence against the witness in terms of his credibility.
Oh, that is the finality rule, isn't it? It prevents evidence being adduced from additional sources on matters solely relevant to credibility.
Yes, that's exactly right. Again, the credibility rule would ordinarily prevent the statement from being admitted. However, Section 106 has created an exception to the rule, where in cross-examination of the witness, the substance of the evidence was put to the witness and the witness denied or did not admit or agree to the substance of the evidence. I guess the whole point of me explaining all of this is to illustrate just exactly how many provisions there are surrounding the contesting of a witness's credibility in cross-examination. In light of this, perhaps the quote is quite right in suggesting that that moment where the credibility of the witness is compromised, that is at the heart of the trial.
So what do you think, Sunny? Do you agree?
Well, to be frank, I take a rather different view. I will concede that there are indeed many provisions concerning credibility in the Uniform Evidence Act. However, I think the very existence of these provisions detracts from the proposition that contesting credibility is at the heart of the trial.
The existence in itself?
If you think about it, Lewis, the credibility rule is there to ensure that the trial focuses on the facts in issue. If anything, that is at the heart of the trial, not the contesting of a witness's credibility. The other provisions that Olivia mentions are merely exceptions to that rule. I think this is reinforced quite strongly, in fact, by many other sections of the Uniform Evidence Act, such as Section 41, which disallows a cross-examiner from asking misleading or confusing questions. This rule allows the court to strike a balance between allowing a party to test its opponent's evidence and protecting the witness from unfair treatment. So in the trial that we cited above, Section 41 was in action as well. The defense counsel attempted to use a police statement but falsely claimed it to be a sworn statement. And I think there is a real concern about keeping the trial on track. That is focusing on contesting the facts and issue. And for me, that is at the heart of the trial.
With all due respect, Sunny, I believe that notwithstanding the policy behind Section 102 to prevent a trial from straying into a contest of credibility, it tends to go down that path anyway. The Section 189 voir dire that preceded the exit I pointed to earlier also dealt with a prior inconsistent statement by concerning whether the garage storing the firearms was rented out. All those sections we discussed earlier concerning the credibility rule and the exceptions would have been employed to get the evidence admitted in the first place. And so again, we see this focus on credibility.
Well, to be fair though, Olivia, the voir dire was not so much focusing on the admissibility of the prior inconsistent statement in question, but whether the new evidence, which consisted of ledgers that confirmed the occupation of the garage, should be excluded under Sections 135 and 137.
Just for our listeners out there, Section 135 gives the court discretion to refuse to admit evidence if its probability value is substantially outweighed by the danger that the evidence might be unfairly prejudicial to a party, or be misleading or confusing, or cause or resulting undue waste of time. Section 137, which applies solely to criminal proceedings, provides that the court must refuse to admit evidence adduced by the prosecutor if its probability value is outweighed by the danger of unfair prejudice to the defendant.
Yeah, thank you, Lewis. The judge performed a balancing act between the probability value of the new evidence against the unfair prejudice effects on the defendant, and found, pursuant to Section 137, that the evidence should be excluded on grounds of unfair prejudice outweighing probability value. And we see here another element of the trial, this notion of fairness.
Sorry to cut you short here, Sunny, but that's all we have time for today. I suppose as a final word, I will quote Justice Kirby from Whisperon Proprietary Limited and Dixon. To reduce the case to a simple context of credibility was to fall in the trap of irrationality, and the risk of prejudice turning the court's process into one of punishing the respondent for her forensic performance instead of evaluating the objective testimony in the context of all the evidence called at the trial.
So what do you think, listeners out there? Tweet us at hashtag Legal513 and remember to keep submitting those topics. Thank you, Olivia. Thank you, Sunny. Tune in again tomorrow for more on Layman Litigators. Have a good day.